Welcome to this session, where we will go into details on wideband impedance measurement techniques in the human ear canal. This work actually started out more than 10 years ago, just prior to developing the new high-frequency ear simulator for HATS. The agenda for today, we'll start out with a brief introduction. Then we would look at the measurement method developed specifically for the purpose of obtaining high frequency measurement in the human ear canal, going through the measurement setup, simulation models, compare the two-load, the multi-load, and the semi-multi-load calibration procedures. Next to real ear measurements, where we will get an overview of the test subjects, measurement preparations, present impedance at the measurement plane, and present the propagated impedance at a common theoretically reference plane in the ear canal, where we can calculate mean human impedance, look at demographic divisions, and compare with an artificial ear, the IC7-11 coupler. Finally, time for questions. Most smartphones, headsets, headphones, and hearing aids of today are generally largely affected by the human ear canal impedance. Therefore, the impedance load of the ear simulators used to evaluate multimedia devices should be representative of the human ear in the full audio bandwidth to obtain reliable measurement results. However, the present ear simulators of today have not been verified against humans above approximately 7 kHz, and no consistent human ear canal data seems to be available at frequencies above 8 to 10 kHz. The reason for this is that measurements in the human ear canal are very difficult to perform for several reasons. They're usually obtained at some unknown position in the ear canal relative to the eardrum. Often you see leakage between the measurement device and the ear canal. Length resonance in the ear canal can also easily impact the accuracy. And last but not least, the conditions of the subject, the human subject, the day of the measurement takes place, can also play a major role. So the work we took on was to investigate and refine the so-called two-load impedance measurement method introduced by Rabinowitz in 81, and following apply the method on a larger in vivo study on humans. The two-load method is based on measurements in two known reference load cavities, for thereby estimating the thevenin equivalent of a transducer source or the input impedance of an unknown load connected to the source. As illustrated to the left, we have the known reference load cavity 1 here, cavity 2 here, and the impedance probe to the left is then in turn connected to reference load cavity 1, 2, and the unknown load, here shown as a simple cavity, and below shown as an ear canal or an ear simulator. And to the right, we see the impedance probe device in more details. We have the transmitter probe microphone here, and the receiver probe microphone here, connected using two thin tubes to the reference load here, using an airtight interface in black, shown here. We have a total of 7 different reference load cavities, and to the right, we see a more complex load, the IC711 coupler, which uses the same interface. The limitations associated with the two-load method is that it starts to break up when the frequency approaches the first anti-resonance, which typically happens around 5 to 6 kHz in a typical human ear canal, and also that it tends to generate a non-physical negative resistance. So improvements were required before we could use the method to measure for measurements on humans. Here's an overview of all the reference load cavity used. They range in volume from 40 cubic millimeter to 1285 cubic millimeter. We have the diameter and the length listed here. We have also listed the first mode, that is the frequency where the cavity starts to break up, which happens at above 25 kHz for the small ones and already at around 6K for the large ones. At that frequency, the cavity no longer behaves like a compliance. We have also listed the impedance at 100 Hz of the cavities, and the small cavities has, of course, a much higher impedance than the large one. As an example of a complex load, more complex load, we have the IC711 coupler with a measurement microphone here, 12.5 mm ear canal extension here, and we have narrow slits leading to two annular cavities here. Well, yes, I just switched off my camera for you to better see the results on the coming slide. I'm sure you don't mind. In the two-load method, the impedance of the reference loads is estimated analytically by the expression 1 shown here. It is assumed that the sound pressure may be regarded constant across the diameter of the cylinder, and that we excite and pick up through the full diameter of the cylinder, and the sound pressure waves propagate along the longitudinal direction as plane waves. In practice, especially when we measure on real ears, it's not possible to establish such ideal conditions. On the graph to the right, we compare the impedance of reference load cavity 1285 cubic millimeter when we calculate analytically by the expression in one and by a finite element simulation made from a 3D model of the exact geometry where we excite and pick up through the small probe tubes of the impedance probe. As we can see, there's a large difference, especially at the minimas, both in frequency and amplitude. We have therefore replaced the expression in one by finite element simulation models of all reference load cavities. To illustrate the effect of using simulated impedances of the reference load, we here try to calibrate a measurement of the cavity 1006 cubic millimeter by both calibration procedures using analytical and simulated impedances of the two reference load 1285 and 200 cubic millimeter. The blue trace is the reference result from a simulation. And as we can see, when we use the analytical expression, we get a relatively large error in the magnitude around the first minima and again above the first maxima. We also see that the two load with simulated impedances of the reference load still generate a small error at the minima. We can also note that even though we use the simulated impedances of the reference load, the two load still generate a negative resistance around the maxima. From the simulation models, we here take a look at the sound pressure magnitude of the sound pressure inside the large reference load cavity 1285 cubic millimeter and the small cavity of 200 cubic millimeter. The two acoustical waveguides are also located on top of the cylinder, the transmitter to the left and the receiver to the right. At lower frequencies, depending on the size of the cavity, the sound pressure field is uniform within the cavities. But for the large cavity, 1285 cubic millimeter, we have quarter wavelength resonance at 5.95 kHz as illustrated in A, and at 10.7 kHz, we have half a wavelength resonance. For the smaller 200 cubic millimeter cavity, the resonances move up in frequency and we have the first transfer mode in C at 26.5 kHz and the first length mode at 38.9 kHz. E shows the half wavelength resonance at 12.8 kHz for the IC711 coupler. So, another advantage will be to use smaller reference load in general as undesirable effects of the resonances is moved to higher frequencies and out of the frequency range of interest. However, the disadvantage of that is that they have a very high impedance, especially at low frequencies, often much higher than the unknown load. So, to conclude on this, it would make sense to divide the frequency range in two and use the larger reference loads at low frequencies and the small reference loads at high frequencies. The two-load calibration procedure can be further improved by measuring on more than two known reference loads yielding an overdetermined set of equations for finding the unknowns. However, this requires all reference loads to be measured at any measurement session. This may be quite cumbersome to perform in practice in an in vivo study on humans, which may take place over several days or weeks, and where several human factors contribute to the difficulties in obtaining reliable measurements. Therefore, we developed a simpler method called the semi-multiload, where only two reference loads, as with the two-load method, is measured at each measurement sessions. The calibration is then performed as post-processing, which involves measurements on all the reference loads only once, and moreover, dividing the frequency range in two, as already discussed. In the graph, we compare the multiload and the semi-multiload calibration procedure. We measure the input impedance of the cavity 1006 cubic millimeter again, measurement calibrated by the multiload and the semi-multiload calibration procedure are shown in green and red, respectively. The green error bars shows three times the standard deviation of the multiload calibration procedure, and therefore they will correspond to the range of impedance estimates when using the two-load calibration procedure with simulated impedance of the reference loads. In figure A, the magnitude of the impedance is plotted, and it shows that the multiload and the semi-multiload curve are almost identical. Figure B shows the resistance, and it's also very similar for the multiload and semi-multiload, except that the low frequencies, they are also both positive up to at least 20K, so the problem with negative resistance has diminished. Graph C shows that the reactance of the multiload and the semi-load calibration procedures are very similar. The error bars around the resistance in graph B also shows that impedance estimates using the two-load calibration procedure can easily yield a negative resistance in some of the frequency range, which is not physically possible in a passive cylinder such as 1006 cubic millimeter. Here we use a more complex load, the IEC 711 coupler, to compare the multiload and the semi-multiload to simulation. The simulation is also made using finite element simulation and including viscothermal losses, and it's shown in the blue trace. The frequency range is split in two at 3 kHz, and the multiload uses two sets of four, and the semi-multiload uses two sets of two reference loads. Large reference loads are used at lower frequencies, and small reference loads are used at higher frequencies. The multiload and the semi-multiload calibration procedure yields very similar estimates of the impedance of the IC 711 coupler. The problem with negative resistance when using the two-load calibration procedure can also be observed in the resistance plot graph B. The error bars shows that statistically some two-load combination will yield a negative resistance below approximately 150 Hz and beyond 20K. This slide shows the same results for the IEC 711 coupler as the previous slide, just plotted relative to simulations. Green curve is multiload, red is semi-multiload, and the black shows three times the standard deviation. The relative difference for all three curves are below 10% in most of the frequency range up to 20K, except close to resonances. This is also the case for the reactance as shown in graph C. However, for the resistance as shown in graph B, the relative difference and the standard deviation, especially close to and beyond the half wavelength resonance, are much higher. This is probably because the resistance is much smaller than the reactance and therefore difficult to measure with low uncertainty. The reactance is about 10 times higher than the resistance. Since the measured input impedance magnitude calibrated by the semi-multiload and the multiload calibration procedure has relatively small discrepancy compared to detailed simulations, and since the standard deviation of the multiload calibration procedure is small, These procedures seem to give reliable estimates of the input impedance magnitude of complex structures such as the IC711 coupler in the full audio bandwidth up to 20K, and is expected to do so for measurement in real ears if other necessary precautions are taken. Having the measurement method in place, we are now ready to perform real ear measurements. Just to clarify, we want to measure the impedance in the ear canal from the tip of the impedance probe to the tympanic membrane, as well as the impedance of the middle ear seen through the tympanic membrane. We are not measuring the fluid-filled inner ear. Here's a table with the 32 adult subjects included in the study. The age ranged from 26 to 60 years, with a fairly even age distribution, and all with normal hearing. Of the 32 subjects, 19 were males, 13 females, 23 right ears, 9 left ears, 25 from Denmark, and 7 remaining from the rest of the world. A lot more details on the test subjects is available on this slide. Detailed information about the full ear canal geometry of all test subjects participating in the study was available from the first of its kind, to our knowledge, larger in vivo MRI-based study of the human outer ear. The anatomy of the ear canal from the bottom of the conga to the eardrum of in total 44 adult subjects has been accurately retrieved, 32 of which are the subjects included in this study. You can even note the protruding part of the eardrum where the malleus bone is connected behind the eardrum. From the geometry data, individual ear molds for all subjects was fabricated. This ensured that an optimal seal and fit was obtained when inserting the impedance probe assembly into the ear canal, and that the measuring precision at the measurement plane of the impedance probe relative to the eardrum in the ear canal was known. The measurement plane of the ear mold is positioned somewhere between first and second bend in the ear canal. An attempt was made to have approximate the same insertion depths across subjects. However, this was difficult because of the large variation in ear canal geometries, and because the measurement session should at the same time not be too uncomfortable for the subject. To give an idea of the large variation in ear canal geometry, here's an example of a small, medium, and large size ear canal and the corresponding individual ear mold. The cross-sectional area at the measurement plane, the tip of the ear mold, is 17 square millimeter, 46 square millimeter, and 108 square millimeter. The ear mold have two holes for the connecting tubes, which were placed with the same spacing and the same tubes as was used when the impedance probe assembly was connected to the reference load cavities. A day or two before the measurement took place, the subject had their ear canal carefully cleaned with an agent and lukewarm water to ensure that any earwax or dirt was removed. If a subject was not well on the scheduled day, had a cold, flu, etc., the measurement was postponed. The ear mold was inserted in the ear canal of the subject with the two probe tubes already mounted. Then the subject was seated in a chair and the probe tubes connected to the impedance probe assembly. A step sine sweep in 1/24th octave bands from 35 Hz to 25 kHz was then performed at normal listening level. All measurements were repeated 3 to 4 times until the same overall frequency response could be obtained. It was ensured that no leakage was introduced between the ear mold and the ear canal, which usually appears as a roll-off at low frequencies. Some subjects were, however, rejected for this and other reasons, and it is in general very difficult to obtain reliable measurements on adult subjects, even though careful preparations have been made. In this graph, the impedance at the measurement plane is shown for all 32 subjects. In the bare measurement results, a significant variability in impedance across subjects is noted, especially at frequencies above 3 to 4 kHz where resonances and anti-resonances occur. This variability is due to the variable pass length between the measurement plane in the ear canal and the eardrum, and to the large intercontact variation in ear canal geometries, but also to what goes on in the middle ear. To compare features of ear canal impedances and to obtain an estimate of the mean human ear canal impedance that preserve characteristic features of individual ear canal impedances, it is therefore desirable to propagate the impedance measurement to a common theoretical reference plane of the ear canal. We decided to use the half wavelength resonance to align at and used the frequency at 9.4 kHz, which was obtained from the average calculated wavelength at the half wavelength resonance frequency for all 32 subjects. We could also have chosen the quarter wavelength resonance. However, the half wavelength resonance is present in both the input and the transfer impedance. Furthermore, the frequency of the minima is quite sensitive to the discontinuity we have in cross-sectional area at the measurement plane of the impedance probe between the probe tube and the ear canal. So how do we propagate the impedance? A uniform tube approximation of the ear canal has proven useful for propagating impedance measurement by means of the ear canal reflectance. However, as the full audio frequency range is of interest, the uniform tube approximation may not provide sufficient accuracy. Webster's original horn equation has often been applied to calculate the propagation of sound field in straight one-dimensional waveguides with varying cross-section area. Here, an extension to Webster's horn equation has been derived that also accommodates for the curvature of the ear canal and predicts the longitudinal sound pressure along a curved axis following the center of the ear canal. This approach is able to predict the sound pressure distribution reasonably well, also at higher frequencies in the core region of the ear canal. This propagation process requires detailed knowledge of the ear canal geometry, such as the cross-section areas normal to a centerline axis of the ear canal. Fortunately, this information is obtainable from the MRI-based study of the human ear canals. The process for propagating the impedance is illustrated in this slide. In A, the geometry of the ear canal and ear mold is shown. The mold is aligned inside the ear canal by minimizing the wall-to-wall distance. The center line is a line down through the ear canal that traces out its center. Two intersection planes are also shown. The first intersection plane is at the tip of the ear mold, the measurement plane. The second plane is the propagated plane, where the half-wave resonance is propagated to 9.4 kHz. Between the two intersection planes, there are many very closely spaced planes, which can be approximated by a cone, as illustrated in B and C. The impedance at each next step can then be calculated using the propagation equation from the previous slide. Here, the propagated ear canal impedance of test subject 10 and 17 is showed, resulting in an upward plus 3.6 mm and a downward minus 2 mm shift of the half wavelength resonance, so they coincide at 9.4 kHz. In C and D, both the measured and propagated ear canal impedance is shown in each graph. E and F shows the cross-sectional area at each of the many closely spaced planes between the start and the end plane. The spacing between each plane is about 0.05 mm. This table gives an overview of the propagated path lengths for all subjects and of an ear simulator, the IC711 coupler. A1 and A2 are the cross-sectional areas of the ear canal at the measurement plane and the propagated plane. L1 and L2 are the path lengths from the measurement plane to the tip of the ear canal along the center line of the ear canal before and after propagation. Delta L is the propagation length, and F1 and F2 are the half-wave resonance before and after propagation. Here we see the measured and the propagated impedance of 6 subjects. In the amplitude of the measured data, we see there's quite a spread in the half-wave length resonance, whereas in the propagated impedance, they align nicely up at the same frequency, 9.4 kHz. The two lower graphs show the resistance and the reactance. Finally here, we have the measured and the propagated impedance of all 32 subjects. From the propagated impedances, we are now able to process the data further. Let's start take a look at the mean human ear canal impedance of all 32 subjects, shown here with error bars of 1 standard deviation. The mean human ear canal impedance is very well determined from the lowest frequencies and up to about 4 to 5 kHz, where the standard deviation is about 20 to 30% of mean. At frequencies from 4 to 5 kHz up to 13 to 14 kHz, the impedance is fairly well determined, since the standard deviation here raises to about 50 to 90% of the mean and only slightly above 100% at the quarter wavelength resonance shown here. Beyond 13 to 14 kHz, the impedance is poorly determined, since the standard deviation here generally is higher than the mean. Next, the 32 propagated impedance measurements are demographically divided into female and male groups, and for each group the mean and standard deviation is calculated, shown in graph A. Similarly, demographical division into two age groups of young adults from 26 to 42 years and middle-aged adults from 43 to 60 years are shown in graph B. The mean of the female group is within 1 standard deviation of the male group and vice versa. The mean of the young adult group is within 1 standard deviation of the middle-aged group and vice versa. Therefore, no statistically significant difference in ear canal impedance between female and male and young adults and middle-aged adults can be concluded based on the 32 subjects in this study. However, a slight tendency of a higher impedance can be observed for females as well as for middle-aged adults at lower frequencies. Here, the mean human impedance with error bars of 1 standard deviation is compared to the impedance of the IC711 cup used frequently in this session. The impedance of the IC711 coupler is also propagated by adding a cylindric ear canal extension to make the half wavelength resonance align at 9.4 kHz. The impedance of the IC711 coupler has the same overall form as the mean human impedance. However, at low frequencies, the level of the IC coupler is slightly higher, indicating a slightly too low equivalent volume of the IC711 coupler compared to humans, or at least the humans in our study. It can also be noted that the slope of the curves from low towards mid frequencies are not exactly the same. For the IC711 coupler, the slope is exactly minus 6 dB per octave, whereas for humans, the slope is slightly less steep, around minus 5.5 dB per octave. This indicates that the impedance of humans cannot be approximated by a pure compliance towards lower frequencies, at least not the humans in our study, as is the case for the IC711 coupler. Roughly calculating the equivalent volume at 100 Hz give 1.5 cc for the 711 and 1.9 for humans. This may translate into approximately 2 dB higher sound pressure level in the IC711 coupler than in the ears of humans in our studies in average. Going lower than 100 Hz, this difference can increase, and above 100 Hz, it will decrease. In the frequency range from 1K to about 5K, the IC711 coupler has a level of about 40% or 3 dB lower than the mean human. Around the half wavelength resonance at 9.4 kHz, the amplitude of the two curves match quite well. At higher frequencies above 9.4 kHz, the minima and maxima of the IC711 coupler are quite pronounced. This is probably because the simple cylindric ear canal shape of the IC711 coupler with very little damping is not quite able to reproduce the complex impedance pattern in human ear canals. That completed this session. The final remaining point is time for questions, and I think we will take that live. So I thank you very much for listening in. Those of you who stayed on to the very end, thank you. Bye-bye.